you go ahead and give yourself a round of applause. Thank you, Dave. And Dave has just been a tremendous friend. I know that he's one of the pillars amongst many of you here at First Pres, but he also is just a tremendous, tremendous help to us at Word of Life. We thank you for that, Dave. And Pastor Ted, you have a great pastor as well. And just so good to be here amongst a strong church here at First Pres. The text I read today is not an easy text to preach out of. I've been going through the book of Ephesians at our church, and when we talk about spiritual warfare, in our day and age, it kind of seems hokey or kind of pokey. What, the devil? You know, I thought we retired that guy a long time ago with his red suit and his horns. You know, is there really a devil? Is there really dark forces out there? And going to the juvenile hall every Thursday night from 3:30 to 8 o'clock, and going to Frank Junior High once a week to deal with kids who find themselves in at-risk behavior, drug addiction, and gang violence, and then going over to Pacific High in Ventura, where there's children who cannot go in regular high school. They come from affluent families, and helping them, I've come to realize that the devil is real. Maybe it's not like some of the Hollywood movies we've seen, like Exorcist, and the devil has better things to do than to hang out in houses or to haunt. But as I look at the destruction of the family and the potential and the future of some of these young people, I realize there is a devil. And the devil's primary weapon is not supernatural phenomenon. It's not appearing or speaking to people. The main weapon of the devil is distortion and deception. The scripture we read says that if we are strong in the Lord, that we'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That word wiles in the Greek text is the word stratagems, a military term, that the devil has proven strategies as he's worked for thousands of years, and he's brought down the strongest, the mightiest, the most intelligent of men, and he has certain lies and distortions, half-truths that he tells people that have brought down the greatest and strongest of people, and even the greatest church. I think of Reformation history, which our church is birthed out of. As Presbyterians, we come out of the great Reformation tradition. But did you know that half of the churches that were used to rock the world in Europe have been reduced to no more than a historical site, a museum? And I think one of the biggest lies that the devil tells churches is that they cannot make a difference, that all the hard work that they do does not make an impact. But I believe that is a lie from the devil. And when the devil convinces a church that all the hard work and all the gathering that they do and all the worship services, that it doesn't make a big difference, he's accomplished half of his goal. I also believe that the devil is real. As I think about how the devil lies, steals, distorts, I think about my own life. I think about how now, in the present, I enjoy life so much, having been married 15 years. I just enjoy my wife. I've never regretted marrying my wife. I enjoy being a father. I enjoy seeing my children. So far, God has just been good to us. I don't know if it's because I'm spoiled, but man, life is just great. I go through challenges just like anyone else. I've lost relatives. My mother passed away at a very young age. But life is very good. And I go through challenges like everyone else, developing a church and just all kinds of stress, trying to give a go at it here in Ventura County, just like everyone else. But you know, life is really good. But I think about how the devil used to lie to me when I was a teenager. How had I listened to him, I wouldn't be here today as a pastor. I wouldn't have gone to seminary. I wouldn't be a good husband or a good father or a pastor. In fact, when I used to listen to the lies of the devil, he had me convinced that I had a right to be angry. Remember getting kicked out of the Catholic school when I was 12 years old for bringing marijuana to school. Remember getting jumped in and getting my first tattoo when I was 13 years old, getting jumped into a gang in Santa Barbara. I remember all the turmoil, just the anger and all the lies and distortions that I embraced. And the Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. In another place, Paul says the weapons of our warfare are mighty to the pulling down of strongholds. A stronghold is an idea that exalts itself above what is truly true, above God's truth. A stronghold, I guess, to give us a better understanding of what it is, would be like if you're a mechanic, that one bolt in the corner and your hand is too big and you can't seem to get a wrench or your hand on that bolt and it's just fastened tight, almost frozen onto that bolt, as it were. A stronghold, an area of our mind that's hard to reach. And so, I remember going on angry, getting addicted to worse drugs, getting involved in crime, listening to the distortions and lies in my mind, thinking that I never really had a future. And then my mother, when I was about 15 or 17, became a Christian. And the Bible says, be strong in the Lord. And I think that is the greatest weapon the Christian has to fighting off demonic influence. When the devil comes to kill,